we go in alphabetical order. And I don't know whether I get Shane to stand back over there or not, but I'm going to ask Shane if he leads us off, please. We go for 10 minutes, and then we'll have Damien, then we'll have John, then we'll have Pappy. Is that okay? That's the way I'd like to go. Is that okay? Let's speak for roughly 10 minutes, and then at the end, plenty of room and time for questions. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Chairman, nobody in this room, I believe, has such a deep rooted connection to our county and indeed to our country. And of course, I think of the instrumental role that your late dad would have played as well in both the creation and, most importantly, the stability of our fledgling state over 90 years ago. You know, ahead of the debate tonight, I reflected on the theme and that one word, unity. Of course, there's no disagreement about the issue of unity. It's just all a matter of perspective and who we're unified with. The United Ireland, a union with Britain, a union with a wider Europe. And at this moment in time, people in Ireland, no matter what side you are on, in my opinion, are seeing a lot more unity of purpose because of the realisation of the global economic threats from the US, as evidenced just today, or across the rest of Europe, where fear and hate are now becoming the popular tools in political campaigning. Maybe as an island, we're a lot further on than people give us credit for, especially when the rest take a look at what's happening in their own backyard. And yet we have a long way to go, not just in the North, but in the Republic as well. Now, I've just come from the Solstice Arts Centre, where there was a launch of an exhibition marking the 100th anniversary of Francis Ledwidge's death. And here was a man who was a union official in Slane, secretary of the union in Slane. He was a miner, he was a poet, he was a committed nationalist and a patriot. He was also a man who fought as part of the 10th Irish Division of the 5th Battalion of the Royal Fusiliers and died in the Third Battle of Ypres. And he did so, in his mind, fighting as a nationalist for Irish independence. Yet, Irish men who held beliefs such as these were, in the last few years, written out of Irish history. So what does that say about us as nationalists and republicans? There's a plaque directly across this room at the County Infirmary, erected by the Navan Historical Society, commemorating the three Royal Irish Constabulary men who were injured in the Battle of Ashbourne on the 28th of April 1916, and who later, having been transferred to the infirmary, died there. One of the men was 25-year-old Constable James Gormley, who was a native of Sligo. And he had joined the RIC in 1912. And James's brother was an active member of the Ballintore Irish Volunteers. And James is buried in St Mary's Cemetery here in Navan and is recorded at the Mass. The local Irish volunteers here in Navan turned out to pay tribute to the dead constable and sympathise with his family. And that just goes to show the country of contradictions and divergent views that we are, and that grappling to come to terms with identity. You only have to see the young millionaire sports stars like Murray McIlroy in the North, who's unable to actually articulate what nationality he is. I listened to John this morning on LMFM. He described himself as an Irishman, as a Northern Irishman, as a Britishman, and he was very at ease with his identity. And I thought it was a powerful thing, because I've heard many unionist representatives unable to describe themselves as Irish, which seems odd, because before partition, there was a union in place for Britain, yet we still all describe ourselves as Irish. And John, as our local TV star here, Hector O'Hookagon, actually reminded your local TV star, Stephen Nolan, recently in a TV documentary, we still all are Irish. And I mentioned the two lads on that special show, which was called Break for the Border, and it aired around 3 years ago, because the two lads, as personalities, when they switched lives and for a period and were doing each other's jobs, it illustrated the normality of life for people that a lot of struggling politicians couldn't do. And what was interesting was that while Hector viewed popping up the road to Belfast to do Stephen's show as just another part of our country, Stephen very much saw coming to Dublin as leaving his country. He even stopped his car at Dundalk to get out and kiss the ground out of the Pope. Now, God only knows what disease he got kissing the ground in Louth, but you're better off coming a few miles down the road and kissing the ground here. But it was an interesting insight into his mindset. And the teaser for the show when they aired it was, are these two countries really so very different, or is the border more a state of mind? I mentioned Eaps earlier on as I was speaking about Francis Ledger, and I want to touch on that again in a minute. But firstly, just touching on unity from a practical and political point of view. Many of you would have heard my Fianna Fáil colleague, Senator Mark Daly, on the Michael Reid show yesterday, and he was speaking on his rapporteur's report on Brexit and the future of Ireland, entitled Uniting Ireland and Its People in Peace and Prosperity, for the members of the implementation of the Good Friday Agreement. Now, this is the first report of its kind to show a path to a peaceful unity of Ireland, and it includes contributions from Dr. Cork Hubner, who came before the committee and constructed economic models and scenarios of Irish unification, one of which showed a benefit of some €36.5 billion in the first 8 years of unification. Now, that's a significant statement given the contentions against unification and the continued reference to the £10 billion that subvents the North every year from the British government. And simultaneously, our party is compiling a white paper on unity across a number of areas and fleshing out what a united Ireland might look like, rather than just empty rhetoric on the issue and calls for a border poll. Because if there is not a clear and comprehensive examination of the potential changes to political institutions, our economies, our security, our health systems, even things like transfer of pensions, how that would work, if we don't look at the cost and the timescale over which a transition would happen by way of support payments from the British government, then this would never happen. And we can wave all the flags that we want. Because just like Scotland, the rationale of the middle of the road people from all sides will vote with their pocket and with the future of their children in mind. Now, our white paper forms part of a long-term conversation between or beyond the immediate demands of addressing the impact of Brexit. And secondly, on an emotional level, and in doing so, I return to Eaps once again. 10 years ago, I visited Eaps along with a group from Meath on a cross-border peace and reconciliation trip. We visited the island of Ireland Peace Park, where a stone tablet commemorating Ledger was displayed. And there was a unionist group with us on that trip, a pipe band. It was a freezing cold day in March, and they were there in their kilts. I had a duffel coat on me. And they played a lament for their fallen comrades, for their ancestors. And afterwards, we went for a bowl of soup just to warm up. We were sitting at different tables. We split up so we would talk to each other rather than talk to our own groups. And I was chatting to a number of the band, and they came from Breedy in County Tyrone, tiny little village, less than 100 people, in the Strabane District Council area. And I actually knew where the village was, John, because in my earlier days as a sports reporter, and I was a sports reporter in North Dublin where cricket is strong, and I know you were discussing cricket as well this morning. So I covered cricket in places like Breedy and Wearingstown Cricket Club in County Down, and many of those areas, they were part of the fixture list for senior cup cricket starting off. And the guys asked me where I was from, and I said Navan, and they looked at me, and I said County Meath, and they looked at me again, and the blank expressions I saw, well, it shook me, because if I had said Dudley outside Birmingham, they'd probably have a better sense of where I was from. And I mean no disrespect at all by saying that, but what it taught me is the fact that I had no idea wheresoever in terms of Meath's location on the map, It shook me there and then and told me we've a long, long way to go. Because if these half dozen lads had no idea where Meath was on a map, then that journey for people's hearts and minds in unifying our country still has a way to go. And a lot like Stephen Nolan getting out of his car, kissing the soil, but I hope the next time he sees the sign by the clear, he doesn't feel moved to have to do that. Finally, can I say, in terms of that journey, progress on all sides is being made. I know that at our Ardesh and at our Cordial Fall dinners, we have unionist representatives that come, and indeed we have some unionist, young unionist activists that have attended at the invitation of our Oprah representatives as well. Now what is noticeable is that when they come, they won't be pictured for fear of misrepresentation of their actions within their own community. That's very sad, because they're trying, they're making the contact with us, but they're afraid that by coming and actually engaging and discussing, that will be misrepresented. So change is happening, but change is always slow. However, as I said at the outset, the things that unify us in this country are far greater than the things that divide us. And I firmly believe that as a people, we are far better off together than at odds with each other.